Now, salvation, as you well know, it is a gift of a gracious God to a justly condemned mankind. And there's no work that we can perform to earn our innocence before God. We all understand that. Now, this gift of salvation is offered to people through the message of God's saving work in Christ. Now, that message, the gospel, it's the means through which God calls one to salvation and exercises his saving power. The gospel, that message, is the seed through which lost humanity receives the new birth. Now, all of that you understand. Now, one of the theological convictions of churches of Christ is that baptism is the moment. I see Fanning. Okay, that's my sign. That's a sign under my household. See? One of the theological convictions of churches of Christ is that baptism is the moment at which the penitent believer appropriates through faith the benefits of Christ's atoning death. It's the moment at which one receives by faith the blessings associated, receives salvation and receives all the blessings associated with that. In other words, salvation is by grace, through faith, in or at the time of baptism. Now, maybe in years past, we could safely assume that everybody in churches of Christ understood the biblical basis for that view, but I don't think that holds anymore. I think many people in churches of Christ have absorbed this idea by association rather than personal study, and they think of it as a mere restoration tradition rather than a truth of God. Now, in this class and the next, what I'm going to be doing is explaining the biblical basis for the view that baptism is the moment at which the penitent believer receives through faith the blessings of Christ's atoning death. Baptism is the God-ordained way for believers to express their faith, to call out to God so as to receive the gift of salvation. Now, I taught this class a couple of Wednesday nights during the summer quarter of 2011. But every 5 years on this topic is certainly not overkill. So I've got 2 weeks. I've got this Sunday and next Sunday before beginning a new class in the auditorium. That new class is going to be the historical case for the resurrection. But I had this window, so I thought it was a good time to repeat this. And most of you weren't here anyway, so there. But all right, I want to spend this class, I doubt I'll get through it, but I want to spend this class on the association of baptism and forgiveness. And then next week, I will look at some objections to the things that I'm saying to you and also look at some church history on what is the church's view of baptism throughout history. Some of those things may surprise you. Now, before his ascension to heaven, Jesus charged the disciples in Matthew 28, verse 19 and 20, to go and make disciples by means of baptizing and teaching. And they were commanded to administer the rite of baptism as part of a person's becoming a disciple. And we see them doing that throughout the New Testament. Now, the baptism they were commanded to administer was a baptism into the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And into is the meaning of that preposition. The American Standard Version, in fact, renders it that way. And in his book, Prepositions and Theology in the Greek New Testament, yes, there is a book by that name. Prepositions and Theology in the Greek New Testament, the Greek scholar, Murray J. Harris, he says the following about the meaning and function of the preposition eis in the phrase to baptize into the name of. He says, since the salvific work of Jesus is inextricably linked to his name, to baptize into the name of the Lord Jesus means to endow a person through baptism with the benefits of the salvation accomplished by Jesus Christ. So then, when the phrase eis ta anima, into the name, is used with baptizo, baptize, the person being baptized is viewed as passing into the secure possession and dedicated protection. He now quotes the standard Greek lexicon, Bauer, Dankert, and Gingrich, but into the secure possession and dedicated protection of the triune God, Matthew 28:19, or Lord Jesus, these other verses where baptism into the name of Jesus is used. And he says, compare 1 Corinthians 1:13-1:15, where a putative baptism into Paul's name is equated with belonging to Paul. In other words, baptism is the moment of a spiritual transition. It's the moment of a spiritual transition. It's the time when one passes from not being in the possession and protection of the triune God or the Lord Jesus to being in that protection and possession. So you see it as a transition. So it's not surprising, given that function, it's not surprising to see in the New Testament that a penitent believer's sins are not forgiven until he or she is baptized. You know well Acts chapter 2, and I think it's very clear in that regard. Acts chapter 2, 36 through 40, those who were convicted of their sin, those who were cut to the heart by Peter's sermon, they asked what they needed to do. And as you well know, Peter replies in verse 38, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. He then declares in verse 39 that promise is programmatic. It was for all people, for all time. And then in verse 40, he pleads with them and warns them. He pleads with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Now, this Greek phrase, for the forgiveness of sins, here it has your, it has that pronoun with it, but this phrase, for forgiveness of sins, it occurs four other times in the New Testament. And in each of those occurrences, it is clear that the preposition is used to indicate the purpose or the result of the described action, and not to refer to something that preceded the described action. Here you see, for example, Matthew 26:28. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. In order, you see, that forgiveness might be provided. It is poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Luke 24:46-47. This is what is written, the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations beginning at Jerusalem. Well, in order that forgiveness might be received. Repentance for forgiveness of sins. You see that. You see here in Mark and Luke 3:3 is essentially the same as Mark 1:4. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins in order that forgiveness might be received. So here the standard, in light of that, you see the standard Greek lexicon, which is this Bauer, Danker, Art, and Gingrich. This is a standard lexicon. It says the following. Ace is used to denote there are a number of functions of prepositions. And so one of those functions is where it is used to denote purpose. And then they specify meaning in order to or to. And the verses they put under that usage are here. He says, ace is used to denote purpose in order to, ace aphesin hamartion, for forgiveness of sins, so that sins might be forgiven. And then you see Matthew 26:28, Mark 1:4, Luke 3:3, the verses that I just listed for you, but they also include Acts 2:38. Okay, so they understand. And I put these things up here because sometimes people say, oh no, that's just Church of Christ talk. No, it's not. You see, this is the standard Greek lexicon. Murray Harris doesn't have anything to do with Churches of Christ. So this is something that's understood. People recognize this. Rick Oster, who does have something to do with Churches of Christ, but he's a leading New Testament scholar, Oster says, in light of the clear meaning of the prepositional phrase eis aphesin hamartion, in these four other occurrences in the Greek New Testament, it certainly requires special pleading and a tendentious use of Greek grammar to miss the point of this prepositional phrase in Acts 2:38. And I agree. You have to do some large handsprings. And this certainly is confirmed by the following verses in Acts 2. They are told to repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of their sins. Peter pleads with them to save themselves, which clearly means by heeding what he just said to do, that is to repent and be baptized. And then Luke tells us in verse 41, those who accepted that, he says, save yourselves. What do we have to do? Repent and be baptized. Save yourselves. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and they were added to their, about 3,000 were added to their number. Then in verse 7, the Lord added to their number daily. Who's he adding? Those who were being saved. Okay, so to me, it takes a real effort to miss the fact that submitting to the baptism that Peter commanded, by doing that, people were being added to the saved. I mean, that just, it seems to me quite clear. And if somebody, in my judgment, wasn't coming to that text with some other idea that it cannot mean that, it would slap them in the face. It seems quite clear to me. Consider the case of Paul's conversion. It's reported, as you know, in three places in Acts. In Acts 9, Acts 22, and Acts 26, an extremely bright light from heaven surrounds Paul, and in response, he falls to the ground, and a voice says to him in Aramaic, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? It's hard for you to kick against the goads. And Paul asks the one speaking who he is, and he says, I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom you are persecuting. Well, now that's an eye-opener.
Yeah.
Okay, here's Paul. They're claiming this dead guy's alive and claiming he's the Messiah. He's on the road there. He's going to go persecute him. And now Jesus appears to him and talks to him. Okay, he said, I'm Jesus of Nazareth, whom you're persecuting. Paul will then ask what he should do. And Jesus told him to go into Damascus, where he would be told all that he must do. Now, having been blinded, Paul is led by the hand into Damascus. And there he spends 3 days fasting and praying to God. God gave him a vision that Ananias would come to him. And when Ananias comes to him, he tells Paul that God had chosen him to be a witness to the world for Jesus Christ. So Paul, Jesus has appeared to him, spoke, told him to go in there. He's fasting and praying, gets a vision. Ananias comes and he says he's been chosen to be a witness to the world for Jesus Christ. Well, now at that point, Paul is without question a penitent believer. He is without question a penitent believer. He knows the truth about Jesus because Jesus has appeared to him. He's out persecuting the people. He knows what they're saying, and it upsets him because he thinks it's blasphemous. So when Jesus appears to him, he knows the whole story. And now he knows that he's real. And he's ready to be a witness for him to the world. So he's ready to give his life in serving him. He is without question a penitent believer. But despite that penitent faith, Acts 22 verse 16 makes it clear that his sins were not yet forgiven. In other words, he was not yet saved. Ananias says to him, and now what are you waiting for? Get up, be baptized, and wash your sins away, calling on his name. Now, David Peterson, who's a professor of New Testament at a seminary in Australia, no association with Churches of Christ, he says in his commentary on Acts, on this text, in the Pillar New Testament series, he says, baptism is a means of appropriating the benefits of Christ's saving work, wash away your sins, and receiving the promised forgiveness. Acts 2:38. The image of washing in 1 Corinthians 6:11, Ephesians 5:26, Titus 3:5, Hebrews 10:22 is also probably linked to baptism. Outward washing with water expresses the cleansing from sin that is proclaimed in the gospel and received by faith sacramentally in baptism. By grace, through faith, in or at the time of baptism. Okay? Not something the water is doing with these silly ideas that people bring up. No one thinks that. Well, I shouldn't say that. Because some people do. But nobody in our circles, and again, whenever you say nobody, you know, I understand there are exceptions to everything. But, so here you see, this is David Peterson saying this. Paul writes in Ephesians 5, 26 and 27, husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her that he might sanctify her, cleansing her by the washing of the water with the word. Cleansing her by the washing of the water. Well, now, in a first century context, what do you think someone is going to understand by that? What do you think people will understand? As acknowledged by the New Testament scholar Marcus Barth, he's dead now. He wrote the two-volume commentary on Ephesians in the Anchor Bible series, which is a highbrow commentary series. Marcus Barth says, practically all interpreters, Marcus Barth has nothing to do with Churches of Christ. Okay, I have to keep telling you that because of people, you know, you're just some kind of little screwball theological ghetto over here that thinks this. This isn't true. Okay, Marcus Barth says practically all interpreters in the East and West, in ancient, medieval, Reformation, and modern times agree in explaining Ephesians 5:26 as a reference to baptism. Okay, I'm with them. I'm standing in that stream that recognizes that. Just as an example, Andrew Lincoln, well-known New Testament scholar in his commentary on Ephesians in the Word Biblical series, he says, sanctification is explained in Ephesians 5:26 as a cleansing that takes place through washing with water. The definite article, literally the washing in water, may well indicate a specific event, and the readers are scarcely likely to have taken this as anything other than a reference to their experience of baptism. Of course they are. You're right, be like somebody writes to us, everybody's experienced baptism, and they say that, what are you going to understand? Lincoln continues, he says, in 1 Corinthians 6:11, washing and sanctifying occur together as metaphors of salvation with an allusion to baptism highly probable. But here, the explicit mention of water suggests not simply an extended metaphor for salvation, but a direct reference to water baptism. See, for example, Acts 22:16, Hebrews 10:20, not to baptism by the Spirit. So this is what I think. I think, you know, it doesn't seem mysterious to me. So the phrase with a word, by the way, in that text, with a word, it probably refers to the confession of the baptized person that the baptized person makes that Jesus is Lord. It probably, when he says this, cleansing her by the washing of the water with a word, it probably refers to that confession, but it possibly could refer to the proclamation of the person who's doing the baptism that that person was being baptized into the name of Jesus. But either way, it's either that person's confession or the baptizer's proclamation. Titus chapter 3, verse 5. Here it, Paul says there that God saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. Now, in light of Paul's own experience, where Ananias told him to wash away his sins in Acts 22:16, in light of the fact that the only other occurrence of this word washing in the New Testament is in Ephesians 5:26 that we just looked at, where the baptismal reference seems quite clear. In light of what is said elsewhere in the New Testament about baptism, especially in John chapter 3, verses 3 to 5, where Jesus ties being born of water to the Spirit and to rebirth, what you see here reflected in Titus, and in accordance with the majority of commentators. Okay, not idiosyncratic, not screwball, but in accordance with the majority of commentators, Paul is saying that God, in his mercy, saved us at the time of our baptism when we were reborn and renewed by the Holy Spirit. Let me give you some quotes to show you. G.R. Beasley Murray, he's a Baptist scholar, wrote a very well-known book titled Baptism in the New Testament. He says, baptism, commenting on Titus, this text, Titus 3:5, baptism is the occasion when the Spirit works creatively in the believer. Well, that's what we think. We think that is the expression of faith, that is the calling out, and when a person in penitent faith submits to Christian baptism, they are regenerated and reborn by the work of the Spirit, not by the work of the water. You see, not by the work of the water. That's what people think. J.N.D. Kelly, he's a very well-known British scholar of a prior generation, died about 20 years ago. He says in his commentary, the reference is clearly to baptism, which is also described as a washing, literally bath, in Ephesians 5:26. See also 1 Corinthians 6:11. John Stott, presumably you've heard his name. From England, I think John Stott is dead now. But you know how that is. You hear all these names and Megan Al sometimes. Is that person still alive? I don't know. I think Stott has died, but I could be wrong about that. If so, apologies to John Stott. But washing, Stott says, washing is almost certainly a reference to water baptism. All the early church fathers took it in this way. They all did. No mystery, no secret. German scholars, Martin Debellius and Hans Konzelmann, they say in their commentary, bath refers to baptism. As in Ephesians 5:26, the event connected with baptism is called rebirth, although it is not said how this rebirth is affected. It's a work of the Spirit. What are the mechanics of it? You're not told. But it's a work there, you see, of the Spirit, and the Spirit is taking care of that. And here's a Catholic scholar, Raymond Collins. The new life and conversion associated with the baptismal washing result from the working of the Holy Spirit. All right, that's right. You see, by grace through faith, enter at the time of baptism. It is at that point that a person receives the blessings and the benefits of Christ's atoning work. That person is born again. That person is renewed, you see. So you have this. It's not a... Anyway, Romans. Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10 and verse 13. Paul there, he links salvation to confession that Jesus is Lord. And we look at that sometimes and we go, well, wow, that looks different. It's not different at all. That is the confession of faith that is made at baptism. Paul is simply referring to the rite of baptism in terms of its confession. Well, why do you think that? Well, Beasley Murray says in the dictionary of Paul in his letters, the Baptist scholar Beasley Murray, he says here, it is universally acknowledged. Well, is he overstating that? I don't know. When you say universally, you're usually in dangerous ground. But the very fact he would say universally tells you how overwhelming it is, even if that's not technically right. But he says it's universally acknowledged that Jesus is Lord is the primitive confession of faith in Christ that was made at baptism. This isn't a secret. You see, it's not a secret. David Wenham, who taught New Testament at Oxford for many years, David Wenham says baptism involved believing in the heart and confessing with the lips Jesus is Lord, and going down into the water. Romans chapter 10, verse 10. You see, it is this baptismal confession to which Paul links salvation in Romans 10, 9 and 10, and Romans verse 13. You see, well, confession is part of baptism. You can see that fits with the reference to Timothy having made the good confession in association with his calling to eternal life. If that's correct, if this is part of baptism where a person at that time makes the good confession that Jesus is Lord, well, then you could see how the confession would be connected to this idea of the calling to eternal life, because that is when one would appropriate eternal life by grace through faith. And so here we have Timothy in 1 Timothy 6:12. You see that take hold of the eternal life for which you were called, for which you made the good confession. You see, in that good confession, you can see in Matthew 27:11, it involves the identification of who Jesus is. Now you say, well, is that on the right track? Well, Donald Guthrie, another New Testament scholar having nothing to do with Churches of Christ, Donald Guthrie says the good confession is taken by most commentators to refer to Timothy's baptism. Well, you're forcing that. That's some kind of... Am I? Are all these people forcing it? These people who have no association, or are we reading it for what makes the most sense? That's how it looks to me, for sure. You can see this idea of confession being connected to baptism. You see it in Acts chapter 8, verse 37. Now, verse 37 is probably not original. In fact, it may not even be printed in your Bibles. It may be a footnote, because current texts look like that was a later edition. Okay, so that verse is probably not in there, but it still provides early corroboration of the practice of baptismal confession, you see. Here you have, and as they were going along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, see, here is water. What prevents me from being baptized? And Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, you may. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. You see, in terms of this confession that Jesus is Lord, it is not a formula that has to be confessed. It is that truth that has to be confessed. You see? And so whether it's this way, that way, but that is what the person coming to the waters of baptism confesses. That I now have come to the conviction and that the gospel is true. This message of what God has done for mankind in Christ, I now believe, and I am here in repentance, ready to give my life for it. All right, that's the confession. It is summarized in Jesus as Lord. Okay, and here you see just another example of that. All right, so that's this idea of confession in Romans 10. You see that it is part of baptism. Hebrews chapter 10, 19 to 22. Here you see it says, therefore, brothers, since we have confidence for entering the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, a new and living way which he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, the hearts having been sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and the body having been washed with pure water. Paul Ellingworth, who's a New Testament scholar, in his commentary on Hebrews in the New International Greek Testament commentary, has nothing to do, no association with Churches of Christ. Paul Ellingworth says, almost all commentators see here, Hebrews 10, 22, a reference to baptism. Well, so do I. So does that make me odd, strange? I'm odd and strange for other reasons, but does that make me odd and strange? You see, that doesn't. I'm standing in the stream of majority scholarship. And so Ellingworth says that. Just as an example, James D.G. Dunn, if you've looked around in this world at all, his name will be familiar to you. He's a very well-known New Testament scholar. Dunn says the close complementary nature of the two cleansings of heart and body, referred to in Hebrews 10:22, remind us that we cannot separate Christian baptism from conversion. It is related to the cleansing of the heart as the body is related to the heart. It is the outward embodiment of the spiritual transformation which is taking place inside a man. It would simply not occur to the writer or to early Christians generally that the two could be separate. The popular idea that conversion precedes baptism and that baptism is a confession of a commitment made sometime previously is not found in the New Testament. Baptism is the act of faith, part of the total cleansing, which enables the convert to draw near and to enter the Holy of Holies by the way opened up for him by Jesus. You see, so it's not a secret. And if I get to it, after I finish this association of baptism with forgiveness, I'll look at some of the objections. And then if I have time, I'm going to walk you through some of the history of the church. This was understood by everybody for 1,500 years. And it's still understood by a good number of people. But that's not the impression we get growing up in churches of Christ. You see, because we focus on other people who have come out of a particular branch of Christianity and they happen to have a loud or big pulpit. And they're saying, oh, that's all crazy. That's works, 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 works. But historically, they are the odd man out. Okay? And I think biblically, they're the odd man out, as I'm trying to explain right here. Now, sins aren't forgiven until baptism. So I've been looking at the association. Sins aren't forgiven until baptism. Why is that? Well, they're not forgiven until baptism because God has established baptism as the culminating expression of saving faith, as the moment at which one is brought by faith into union with the atoning work of Christ. So Paul says in Romans 6, 3 and 4, he says that our baptism into Christ was a baptism into his death. You see, it is in that submission and penitent faith that I'm put into Christ's death. Well, why would forgiveness be tied to that? Because that is the transition point where I appropriate the benefits. I'm baptized into his death. So it's not surprising. Paul says in Galatians 3, 26 and 27, that our baptism into Christ was a clothing of ourselves with Christ. He says in Colossians chapter 2, verse 11 and 12, that through being buried in baptism, our being buried in baptism, we experienced a spiritual circumcision. Now that's important to understand. See, Paul describes this as a circumcision made without hands. In fact, sometimes it's simply translated spiritual circumcision. This is a circumcision that is done by God. So you cannot analogize baptism to physical circumcision, which people often try to do. And they say, well, you see, it is a New Testament kind of circumcision. Circumcision, we see, wasn't really relevant at all to salvation. Therefore, baptism has no connection. No, this is a spiritual circumcision. You see, so that analogy doesn't work. This is a spiritual circumcision, a putting off of the body of the flesh, the old man. The condemned sinner died with Christ in baptism, and the new man, redeemed and free from condemnation, was raised with Christ in baptism through faith in the working or the power of God. So it is by grace, through faith, in or at the time of baptism. You see, and this is when you have this event, this spiritual circumcision. This is when you get the new birth, the regeneration by the Spirit. This is what Paul is talking about. And since baptism, rather than the sinner's prayer, is the form in which faith is to be expressed for one to get into Christ, it's not surprising that Jesus and Peter, that they both state expressly that baptism is part of receiving salvation. That shouldn't surprise us. You know the text in John chapter 3, verses 3 through 5. Jesus tells Nicodemus that unless a man is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. And then in the very next scene, he has this conversation with Nicodemus where he tells him that. And in the very next scene, John 3:22 through John 4, verse 2, we're told that Jesus, through his disciples, was baptizing people. So he has this conversation, unless a man is born of water and spirit, he cannot see the kingdom of God, cannot enter the kingdom of God. And then the very next scene, what are we told? Well, Jesus, through his disciples, is baptizing. I mean, the connection seems quite easy to be made, and I'm not the only one who thinks that. The former Oxford professor David Wenham, he has written, when Jesus says in John 3:5 that unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God, it is amazing that anyone sees the water as anything but baptismal. This guy's from Oxford. He's got nothing to do with churches of Christ. But he can read. And he recognizes that, and that's how I feel about it. But see, we feel like defensive. Well, no, you know, it's not odd at all. He says it's amazing that anyone sees the water as anything but baptismal. It is amazing given, A, the emphasis on baptism in John chapters 1 to 4, especially in chapters 3 and 4, where Jesus and his disciples are baptizing and thus making disciples, and B, the evidence elsewhere in the New Testament that baptism was the normative way of becoming a Christian and that it was associated with the giving of the Holy Spirit, Acts 2:38, 1 Corinthians 12:12. So, I mean, there's such resistance to this. And it just strikes me as and really some extreme, harsh kind of stuff. And I'm thinking, no, this is quite mainstream. You see, this is quite mainstream. At the time of his conversion, when this conversation, when Jesus is talking to Nicodemus, at the time of this conversation, the gift of the Spirit was separated from the expression of faith that is made at baptism, in that the sending of the Spirit was not until after Jesus' crucifixion. We understand that. John chapter 7, verse 39. But these two are still linked, you see, in divine purpose. Submission to baptism and receipt of the Spirit are linked in divine purpose. So the reception of the Spirit in conjunction with baptism because of faith, it was delayed until Pentecost, in fulfillment of God's purposes. But they are always connected. And Jesus says a man is born of water and spirit. And so that's this idea that in that act, we are made new and regenerated by the Spirit. Now there are some commentators I respect, commentators I've learned from, who reject this understanding that this essential birth from above, which Jesus describes as a birth of water and spirit, they say, look, they reject that this has anything to do with Christian baptism. And they do so because they're convinced that a reference to Christian baptism accompanied by spiritual regeneration, that it would have been incomprehensible to Nicodemus. You see, that this idea that this is later in history, later down the line, when this is actually formulated. So at this point, without this connection being made until Pentecost, Jesus saying this to Nicodemus at this point in his ministry would have been incomprehensible. But I'm not really impressed with that. Because we have here, you see, given that the Messiah was expected by Pharisees, that's Nicodemus's sect, by the way. But given that the Messiah was expected by the Pharisees to come baptizing in water, you can see that implication in John chapter 1, verse 24 and 25. Given that Jesus, through his disciples, was baptizing in water, given the Old Testament connection between water and the transforming activity of the Spirit, that you see in texts like Ezekiel 36, verses 25 to 27, and given that John had proclaimed that the one coming would baptize with the Spirit, well, I think that objection's overrated. I don't think at all it would be incomprehensible to Nicodemus the Pharisee that the idea when Jesus says must be born of water and spirit, that that's the essential birth he's talking about. I think they would connect those dots quite readily, and Jesus is in fact urging him to do so. Mark 16, 16, whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. Uh-huh. All right. So here, this verse, you know, it's textually suspect, okay, meaning it probably is not part of the original Gospel of Mark, but it still reveals a very early understanding of Jesus' teaching about the need for baptism. Now, you know that some say, well, this doesn't say anything about the fate of one who believes and is not baptized. It says that whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Whoever doesn't believe, be condemned. But it doesn't address the person who believes and is not baptized. Well, I mean, that's the clear implication of saying and is baptized. Right? Whoever believes and is baptized. They are both conditions. Otherwise, why say and? You see, why say and is baptized? The logic is the same as in the statement, whoever has a ticket and boards the bus will be given a ride. But whoever does not have a ticket will be left.
Yeah. That's right.
Okay. Okay, so I mean, I think it's clear. It seems quite clear what's going on. 1 Peter 3:21. All right. He says that the saving water of the flood, okay, and he clearly says this, that the salvation, the water is salvific. The water of the flood is saving. And he says the saving water of the flood is a type, the antitype of which, meaning the thing it symbolizes, is Christian baptism. And he says the saving water of the flood is a type. It symbolizes the Christian baptism, which now saves them. All right? It now saves them. I. Howard Marshall, he's dead now, but he was called the Dean of Evangelical New Testament Scholars. There's no association with Churches of Christ. He says in his commentary on 1 Peter, and I think this absolutely nails what goes on with this. He says, the interpretation of this verse has been plagued by Protestant fear of finding in it a basis for the doctrine of baptismal regeneration. Baptismal regeneration is the idea that the rite itself accomplishes the effect regardless of a person's repentance and faith. You see, that, in other words, it is that God has invested the sacrament itself with the power to accomplish its purpose. Okay, well, that's not what we think. You see, we think that that is the God-ordained way of expressing penitent faith so that at that time, God then acts. So he's just explaining what has hobbled understanding of 1 Peter chapter 3. He says, the interpretation of this verse has been plagued by Protestant fear of finding in it a basis for the doctrine of baptismal regeneration. This view ties the experience of receiving the Spirit and being regenerated to the moment of baptism in water and sees this experience as taking place regardless of the repentance and faith of the person baptized. That's baptismal regeneration. That's not us. He continues. There is no justification for this view in Scripture. I agree. He says, what Peter is talking about is the occasion when a person comes to water baptism seeking salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. Baptism saves you is simply a shorthand way of saying God saves you in and through the act of baptism, which is the outward expression of the twin facts that he regenerates you by his Spirit on the basis of the atonement wrought by Christ, and that you come committing yourself in faith and repentance to Christ as your Savior. Let me read you one other one. John Eliot, again, no association with Churches of Christ. He wrote the commentary on 1 Peter in the Anchor Bible Commentary Series. He says, the association between baptism and resurrection, like the earlier link between baptismal rebirth and resurrection, reflects traditional Christian teaching, according to which undergoing baptism was the ritual means for identifying personally with the crucified and resurrected Christ. Romans 6, 4 and 5, 8, 11, Colossians 2, 12, you see the text. This association between baptism and Christ's resurrection makes it clear that it is the resurrection of Jesus Christ that gives baptism its saving efficacy and makes human rebirth possible. Baptism is thus the instrument rather than the agent of salvation, for it is ultimately God who raises Jesus Christ from the dead and through his resurrection confers new life and living hope on those who bear Christ's name, as consistently attested throughout the New Testament. Baptism saves by bringing believers into contact with the saving power of God manifested in the resurrection of Jesus Christ and unifying believers with the resurrected Christ, Romans 6, 8 and 11, Colossians 2. That's what I think is going on. That seems to me to be the clear, consistent teaching throughout the New Testament. Next week, Lord willing, I will talk about the objections to that and then walk you through some church history that I think you might find really interesting. Thanks. All right. Now, last week I went through the biblical case for baptism, and we looked at these different texts quickly, went through them and kind of organized them and explained them in a way that I think demonstrates that Scripture links salvation, forgiveness of sins, and baptism in that a person receives salvation. It is by grace, through faith, in or at the time of baptism. Now, what I wanted to look at today is some of the objections that are made to that claim. And these will be familiar to you, but I wanted to run through those, get through those, and then I want to look at church history see what we can learn from that and see if we're off track or if church history confirms our reading. So I wanted to do that. Now, in my judgment, the primary objection, the root objection to linking baptism to salvation is this idea that doing so contradicts the truth that salvation is by grace through faith, not by works. That you see in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. This idea that if you have faith and baptism, if baptism plays any role or is in any way connected to salvation or forgiveness, well, then you're no longer saved by grace through faith. You're saved by grace through faith plus the work of baptism. And see, and that's the root objection. And when people feel this way, they then think, they say, okay, I know it cannot be connected to salvation. Because Ephesians 2:8 says, you know, by grace through faith, not by works. If I connect it, then I'm going to be contradicting Ephesians 2:8 and 9. So then when you bring up all these texts, you say, look, I know it can't mean that. So it's got to mean something else. And so you get all of these, what I consider squirrely interpretations of these various passages. But I think that's what's driving it. It's this understanding. And I think that idea that if baptism is connected to salvation, somehow it contradicts the truth that baptism is by grace through faith, not by works. I think that idea is clearly misguided. And it seems clear to me when you look, for example, in Luke chapter 8. Luke 18 verses 35 to 43. Here you have this blind beggar who received his sight after persistently crying out for Jesus to have mercy on him. So here he is, he's sitting here, and he's crying out, persistently crying out. And he receives his sight then, and Jesus tells him in verse 42, your faith has made you well. He doesn't say to him, you see, that your faith plus your work of calling out made you well. He simply says your faith made you well, despite the fact that he wasn't healed until he persistently called out in faith. You see, it shows to me something. The fact the blind man did the, quote, the work of calling out for the blessing, that doesn't nullify the truth that the healing was received by grace through faith. Otherwise, Jesus would need to say your faith plus your work of calling out made you well. But he doesn't say that. He says your faith made you well. You see, the same point made the same way in Mark chapter 5. It's evident there, Mark 5, 25 to 34, involving the woman healed of bleeding. Now, her bleeding wasn't cured until she, in faith, reached out and touched Jesus' garment. So here she is thinking, he can heal me, he can heal me. If I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. She goes out and reaches out and touches his garment. She is then healed, and Jesus says to her, what? Your faith has healed you. Your faith has healed you. The fact she wasn't healed until her faith expressed itself in the, quote, work of touching the Lord didn't alter the fact that the healing was received by faith. It didn't nullify that fact. The Lord says, your faith has made you well. He didn't say your faith plus your work of touching me has made you well. He said your faith has made you well. Likewise, the walls of Jericho, they fell only after the Israelites had marched around them 7 days, but the writer of Hebrews says what? By faith they fell. By faith they fell. See, the Israelites, they expressed their faith in the Lord's promise, and he provided the blessing. That's what happens in baptism. A person expresses his faith in the Lord, and God provides the blessing. So that idea, that root objection, doesn't make sense to me, yet you can't shake people off it. But I'm telling you, that's what's driving it. And I look at it biblically, and I say it looks clear to me biblically that that objection is misguided. And so, but that's the first one. Now, some claim that if you link baptism to salvation, well, then what you're doing is you're attributing the washing of our sin to the water of baptism rather than the blood of Christ. Well, that's simply a misunderstanding. Baptism simply is the God-ordained way, the God-prescribed way of calling out for the blessing, the prescribed means of appealing to God for mercy, for the application of Christ's blood. You can look at it as a symbolic prayer. Right? You can say, look, when you submit to baptism, when you undergo this, what I hear is, Lord Jesus, have mercy on me. It is God's prescribed way of calling out in faith for the blessing. I mean, as Peter makes clear in 1 Peter 3:21, the power of baptism to save is drawn not from the water. I mean, obviously not from the water. It's drawn from the resurrection of Christ. You see, which is an event to which one is connected by submitting to baptism. Baptism is an appeal or a pledge. There's some difficulty in how do you understand that particular word. But it's an appeal or a pledge to God. Now, others object to linking baptism with salvation by pointing to those passages that mention only belief or faith as necessary for salvation. See, but those passages, they have to be read in theological context, and they can't be pitted against the host of scriptures that link salvation to repentance, confession, and baptism. I mean, Peter mentions only baptism in 1 Peter 3:21. Paul mentions only repentance in Acts 26:19 and 20. But everybody understands that those statements were predicated on an assumption of faith. When you read those, you say, well, he doesn't mean just everybody understands that those statements assume there is a faith there. In the same way, you see, those texts that mention only faith as necessary for salvation, they assumed baptism as the culminating expression of faith. You can see that exemplified in Acts 2, 40 and 41, Acts 8, 34, 39, Acts 16, 29 to 33. That was general knowledge in the first century church. You didn't have to repeat it every time you said that. It was understood that that was how faith would be expressed. Let me read to you what David Wenham, how he puts this. David Wenham is the former instructor of New Testament at Oxford University. Wenham says, perhaps the most persuasive objection to the baptismal interpretation of John 3:5, he's just talking about that one particular verse, but what he says would apply to all of these. Perhaps the most persuasive objection to the baptismal interpretation of John 3:5 is that John's gospel emphatically and consistently says that it is by believing in Jesus that people have eternal life. An additional sacramental requirement seems out of keeping. But this is to misunderstand baptism in the New Testament church. The evidence we have suggests that baptism was part of conversion, not an additional rite. To be more precise, baptism was the way people put their faith in Jesus. The response to what must I do to be saved was not pray a prayer of commitment in your heart, as in much modern evangelical evangelistic practice, but repent and be baptized. See, this is the way faith expresses itself by God's instruction. This is how he calls for us to do that. Now, some object to baptism's role in salvation by pointing out that the thief on the cross, or better, the rebel or insurrectionist on the cross, that he was forgiven without baptism. And you see that in Luke chapter 23, verses 39 through 43. Now that's true, but first notice that Jesus didn't tell the thief that he would be with him in paradise until he publicly confessed his faith. So I don't want that to slip by you. Notice that he didn't tell him that until the thief publicly confessed his faith. He wasn't blessed when he came to his private internal conviction about Jesus, but when he confessed that conviction with his mouth. So this is another example, you see, of salvation being contingent on faith being expressed outwardly but it's one that everybody recognizes doesn't conflict with the truth that salvation is by grace through faith. We recognize here that he's only forgiven. Jesus says, you'll be with me in paradise only when he confesses, but nobody turns around and says, well, he wasn't saved by his faith. He was saved by his faith plus his work of confessing. So here's another example of that. But the question's whether this episode, whether it gives adequate reason to believe that today God will save one who confesses his faith without baptism. And I don't think it does. I don't think it gives adequate reason to think that. It seems from the accounts that we have in Matthew and Mark that initially both of the thieves were heaping insults on the Lord. Right, they're both doing that. Well, that means that the thief who's mentioned in Luke chapter 23, he came to faith while he was on the cross, which is a circumstance in which baptism is physically impossible before death. He comes to faith when he's on a cross and his life is draining away. He cannot be baptized. So I can see somebody arguing from this that God will save someone who comes to faith in circumstances in which it is impossible to be baptized before death. But that, to me, is not the relevant question. The relevant question is what's the fate of believers who are able to be baptized, but who are not? That's the question, you see, and I see no reason to believe that Jesus intended the thief's waterless confession of faith to be a generally acceptable form of confession. On the contrary, the salvation plan that Christ entrusted to the church, it calls for faith to be publicly expressed in baptism. I mean, you see in Peter, right? Peter says in Acts chapter 2 and verse 39, the promise is for you and your children, for all who are far off, for all whom our Lord God will call. It is programmatic. You see, it's programmatic. It is for all people, for all time. The question is not whether God is able to save apart from baptism. He clearly is able to do that. Yes?
I can't remember the exact scripture, but it says something to the fact that when Jesus, whenever he saves on earth, or whatever he says is going to be saved, will be
yes.
saved. And so at the point, Jesus is alive, whatever he says, God will honor.
Yes.
And you are going... At the point that Jesus has died and instituted this way that we become Christians, he's not there to say anything for anybody else. And so that's how I can see the thief on the cross was allowed a different way in, because Jesus was there and what Jesus said, and, you know, because of that
sure.
scripture
right.
that I can't find. I will look for it.
Sorry.
And that was how, because I actually had a lot of conversations with this exact same thing, and that was how I understood it, to come to understanding that it was allowed to be different because Jesus was alive and could say something different.
Okay.
And he had instituted the baptism because he hadn't died yet at that moment.
No, I think, yeah, obviously Jesus to me says, you're going to be with me in paradise, and Jesus is there, and Jesus is allowing this person to come through. So whether you want to say, well, he's here and can do that. Yeah, that's what I'm saying, is that God hasn't so bound himself, see, where a person, God... He does here as an example. See, the question is, as I said, not whether he can save apart from it. He can save apart from baptism. He hasn't trapped himself into baptism. God is able to do that. You're saying, here's an example of it. Here's God in the flesh, and he says in this particular instance, today you'll come through my sacrifice and you'll be saved. Yeah, see, but the question is not whether he's able to save apart from baptism, but whether he's chosen to do so. In that context, he did. But has he chosen to do so? We see this programmatic statement of how is a person to become a Christian, and you see that. Now, let me say that, same idea. Those who recognize that part of God's revealed way of becoming a Christian or of accepting salvation, that part of that, the baptism is part of that, we need not insist that no unbaptized person can be saved. You see, this always happens, and you get off on all of these hypotheticals, but a person who recognizes that baptism is part of God's revealed way of existence need not insist that. The example I use is that when a father, let's say we have a father who tells his children, that only those who eat all their dinner will be allowed to watch an upcoming television program. He doesn't necessarily mean there can be no exceptions to that requirement. If one child becomes ill and unable to eat, the father wouldn't be contradicting his pronouncement if he let that child watch the show, because his statement wasn't intended to encompass such an extraordinary situation. It wasn't addressing that situation. It was addressing the normal situation. If you don't eat, you can't watch the show. This kid can't eat because he becomes violently ill. So if the father said, you can watch the show, would you say he broke his word? Or would you say, no, his word wasn't intended to encompass the bizarre case? Would you hold him guilty for breaking his word? I wouldn't. I would say he wasn't intending to address that. Now, Scripture clearly teaches that salvation is received by faith when faith is expressed in baptism, but that revelation need not encompass one who, for example, comes to faith while stranded in Antarctica, having never before heard the gospel, and then dies searching for a way to be baptized. You plug in your own hypothetical. You've all heard them, I'm sure. I just don't see the need to insist that God could not say in that circumstance what the New Testament writers revealed wasn't contemplating that kind of bizarre situation. So I feel fine saying that situation, I'm comfortable saying it's outside the scope of what's addressed. So it doesn't trouble me, and I think we get in difficulty sometimes in thinking that. Now, I know that many argue in our fellowship, argue that the thief has no relevance. The thief, this whole situation has no relevance, because even though Jesus died before the thief, which you can see implied in John 19:32 and 33, it's claimed that, look, the thief still died under the old covenant and that baptism was only required under the new covenant. Well, I'm not satisfied with that answer. That's not how I go at it. I'm not satisfied with that answer because, in my judgment, it splits hairs about the timing of the new covenant in a way that's uncertain. And because as I read John chapter 3, verses 3 through 5, I read that to say that Jesus taught the essentialness of being baptized prior to the final institution of the new covenant, but looking forward to the institution of the new covenant. You see, so that's not how I approach it, but I just wanted to acknowledge, I understand there are many people in our fellowship who do that. Now, others object to baptism's role in salvation by pointing out that those in Cornelius' house, those to whom Peter preached the gospel, that they received the Spirit, which indicates they were saved prior to being baptized. This is in Acts chapter 10, of course. So there are people who say, look, so that shows that baptism isn't connected. Now, there are many in churches of Christ who deny that receipt of the Spirit in this particular instance is indicative of salvation. I'm sure you're familiar with that line of argument. Okay, they say, look, that's not what's going on here. The receipt of the Spirit at Cornelius' house was something different. It's not indicative of salvation. They argue that these Gentiles were simply given the miraculous ability by the Holy Spirit in distinction from the indwelling Spirit, which is a hallmark of salvation. So they didn't get that. They simply got miraculous gifts. Now, I don't think that's correct, okay, for reasons that I don't want to take the time to go into, but I'll gladly share with you, particularly if you email me. I'll say much about it, okay? But I don't want to take the time to go into that now. But here's all I want to say about that. If that view is correct, okay, that these people, that the gift of the Spirit that they received was not indicative of salvation, well, if that's correct, well, then they weren't saved before they were baptized, and so that situation doesn't require an explanation. Okay, that's why that argument's being made anyway. But if that's correct, then it's not a problem, right? It's not an indication of salvation prior to baptism. What I want to stress to you is that even if the receipt of the Spirit in this instance, even if it is indicative of salvation, as I think it is, The unique circumstances of that case make it inapplicable to subsequent situations. See, the granting of salvation prior to baptism, in the case of the Gentiles at Cornelius' house, is consistent with a strong baptismal theology. If one recognizes that God has nowhere bound himself never to alter the timing of salvation in relation to baptism. The norm is clearly set in Peter's programmatic statement. That norm is set forth there in Acts 2:38. That norm is confirmed throughout Scripture. It is confirmed throughout church history. But in my judgment, it's an overreading to conclude that God left himself no room to vary the order of things in fulfillment of his purposes in salvation history. And in my judgment, Acts 10 is a case of his doing precisely that. At Cornelius' house, God taught Peter and the other Jews who had accompanied Peter, he taught them that under the new covenant, there was no place for a Jewish nationalism that would withhold baptism from believing Gentiles until they submitted to circumcision. That is, until they first became Jews. You see, and to break through Jewish resistance to administering baptism to the uncircumcised, God demonstrably saved the Gentiles prior to baptism. In doing so, what he's saying, God says loud and clear that it was his will for Gentiles to be saved as Gentiles without the necessity of converting to Judaism and being circumcised. He was announcing it is his will for Gentiles to be saved as Gentiles. And since baptism is the rite in which salvation normally is granted, his will is that Gentiles be saved as Gentiles, that was God's will. That was rightly understood by those on the scene to mean that baptism must not be withheld from believing Gentiles. That's what he's saying to them. You must allow them to be saved as Gentiles. Well, what will that mean in the normal context? In the normal context, that means that when a Gentile comes to faith, you must allow him to be saved as a Gentile. You must allow him to submit to baptism. You see, you cannot insist that he first become a Jew before you will baptize him and thus allow him to receive the gift of life. As Peter concluded in Acts 10:47-48, again in Acts 11:17, see, to do that would be to oppose God. To refuse to administer baptism to a believing Gentile would be to oppose God. He understood what God was saying. By demonstrably saving the Gentiles as Gentiles, he understood what that meant. That meant that they needed to be baptized as Gentiles. And so he's telling now the fact that the baptism in their specific case, the fact that their particular baptism wouldn't be the time of their salvation, God having for his specific purpose already having given them that gift, that's beside the point. What God was communicating by his action is that the baptism of believing Gentiles was not to be conditioned on their being circumcised. And that point was able to be made by saving them prior to baptism, precisely because of the understood normal coupling of baptism and salvation. That's how he made the point to them. If I save you before baptism, the normal way of salvation and receiving it is baptism. He's saying to them, you cannot withhold salvation from believing Gentiles. You see, you cannot make them become Jews first, and they got it. But he was doing that, and he needed to do that there. The normal connection of salvation, baptism and salvation, it was altered in this particular case to overcome this false but deep conviction of the Jews that salvation would come to Gentiles only in association with their conversion to Judaism. Okay, you had this where this was an idea that, yes, Salvation is going to be available to Gentiles, but through Judaism. And so he altered that to overcome that. See, once that point was made, then Gentile conversions followed the normal pattern. Having taught them that, listen, you must receive believing Gentiles and not withhold baptism from them. You must not withhold salvation from them. They understood that. But the way he taught them that was he saved them first because of the normal coupling of baptism and salvation. Oh, okay. They don't have to be Jews first. Now I get it. So now I go and preach and they come to faith and then I will not say to them. Now we still had struggles with this, you know, right, in the church. Let me read to you what David Warren says. David Warren says in his chapter, Can Anyone Withhold the Water, from his book, Early Christian Voices. David Warren didn't show up here on my screen. There he is. He says, with subtlety, Luke argues in his narrative that the Jewish church had rationalized the divine plan for the inclusion of Gentiles. Yes, God would accept the Gentiles into his church, but first they must become Jews. Before Gentiles can be baptized in water, they must undergo a circumcision of the flesh. But here in the story of Cornelius, God showed the Jewish Christians that their assumption was clearly wrong. That's what I think is going on. Okay? That's what I think is going on. So it's a mistake once that point's made. You see, it is a mistake to try and make this exceptional situation normative, to generalize it so as to contradict the remainder of the New Testament. So somebody says, well, here we have this example. And you say, so wait a minute, what you want to say is I have this extraordinary example in salvation history where God is making a statement about Gentiles and how they're to be received. You want me to take that and then say that's normative and then wipe away everything Peter said and all of these other examples from all the texts that we went through last week. I said, no, that's not the way to look at it. The way to look at it is that's an exceptional situation where God was sending a signal, and that is not to be something that you generalize. You see, but I don't think God was trapped, so he didn't have the flexibility to send the signal and the message that way. Okay, now I said, a lot of people look at that and say, no, I don't think that's right. You have to say that they weren't saved. Okay, I don't agree with that. I've just told you why. You can do with that what you want. All right, let me talk about baptism in history. Okay, because this is important, and I think this is something that is often underplayed. One way of checking the understanding of baptism that I've been presenting to you, one way of checking that is by post-apostolic Christian history. Okay, if the understanding, if what I'm telling you about the link between baptism and salvation, if that link is correct, then you would expect some confirmation from the testimony of the early church. Okay, Scripture remains the authority, but history can aid in its interpretation. It can serve as a check on our reading. If you come away with some understanding of something, and you look at the early church, and nobody understood it that way, well, that's a warning to you. Okay, that's a warning that maybe you've missed something. Well, maybe your stuff's so tight you can go and say, no, they missed something. All of them. Okay? But if you have nobody with you, you're in trouble. It's that kind of thing. Now, on the issue of baptism and conversion, the witnesses from the early church are unanimous and unambiguous. And I'm going to run you through some of them. I'll take you from the early second century up into the beginning of the third century. And let's look at how some of these folks looked at this. In a writing known as the Epistle of Barnabas, this is generally dated from AD 132 to AD 135, though some have argued for an earlier date, it includes the following. Let us inquire if the Lord was careful to give a revelation in advance concerning the water and the cross. It was written concerning the water with regard to Israel, how they will not receive the baptism that brings forgiveness of sins, but will establish another for themselves. Perceive how he defines the water and the cross together. For he says, blessed are those who with hope in the cross went down into the water. He means this, that we go down into the water full of sins and uncleanness, and we come up bearing as fruit in our heart reverence and having hope in Jesus in our spirit. So we see here this idea how this is understood. The shepherd That's the name of an apocalyptic work that was written by a Christian in Rome named Hermas. And it was probably composed over a period of decades in the first part of the second century. So from 100 to 150, over a period of decades there. And it possibly began in the early as the 90s being composed. But it includes the following. The tower that you see being built is myself, the church. I ask her, why, lady, was the tower being built on the waters? She said, hear then why the tower was being built upon the waters. It is because your life was saved and will be saved through water. Do you wish to know who are the other stones which fall near the waters and are not able to be rolled into the water? These are those who heard the word and wanted to be baptized into the name of the Lord, but when they remember the purity of the truth, they change their minds and return again to their evil desires. I said, sir, or Lord, addressing the shepherd, the angel of repentance, I heard from some teachers that there is no other repentance except the one when we went down into the water and received the forgiveness of our former sins. He said to me, you have heard correctly, for it is so. Now, Justin Martyr was a Gentile from Samaria who converted in Asia and spent his early years teaching in Rome. He was martyred around 165 AD. Justin Martyr wrote this. He says, we shall explain in what way we dedicated ourselves to God and were made new through Christ, lest by omitting this, we may seem to act deceptively in our explanation. As many as are persuaded and believe that the things said and taught by us are true and promise to be able to live accordingly are taught while fasting to pray and ask God for forgiveness of past sins while we pray and fast together with them. Then they are led by us to where there is water, and in the manner of the regeneration or rebirth by which we ourselves were regenerated or reborn, they are regenerated or reborn. For at that time they are washed in the water in the name of God and the Master, the God, the Master, and the Father of us all, and of our Savior Jesus Christ and of the Holy Spirit. For Christ also said, unless you are regenerated, born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. So there you have Justin Martyr, Theophilus of Antioch. He was bishop of Antioch, and he wrote his apology to Autolycus. This is around AD 180, and he says, on the fifth day came into existence the living creatures from the waters, through which the manifold wisdom of God is made plain. For who would be able to count their multitude and variety? Moreover, the things that come from the waters were blessed by God in order that this might be a sign that people were going to receive repentance and forgiveness of sins through water and the bath of regeneration, Titus 3:5, namely all those who come to the truth and are born again and receive a blessing from God. I'll give you just a couple more, three more, okay? Irenaeus, bishop of Lyon, writes in his work, Proof of the Apostolic Preaching, which was written around AD 185. Irenaeus says, now this is what faith does for us as the elders, the disciples of the apostles have handed down to us. First of all, it admonishes us to remember that we have received baptism for remission of sins in the name of God the Father and in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who became incarnate and died and was raised and in the Holy Spirit of God. And that this baptism is the seal of eternal life and is rebirth unto God, that we be no more children of mortal men, but of the eternal and everlasting God. Clement of Alexandria, Christian teacher, who according to Eusebius, he headed the catechetical school that was associated with the church in Alexandria, Egypt. And around 190 or 200, he writes this. Being baptized, we are illuminated. Being illuminated, we are made sons. Being made sons, we are perfected. Being perfected, we are made immortal. This work is variously called a grace, gift, illumination, perfection, washing. It is the washing through which we are cleansed of our sins, the grace gift by which the penalties of our sins are removed, the illumination through which the holy light of salvation is beheld, that is, through which the divine is clearly seen. Instruction leads to faith, and faith together with baptism is trained by the Holy Spirit. We who have repented of our sins, renounced our faults, and are purified by baptism, run back to the eternal light, children to their Father. So you see the significance there in Clement. And lastly, we have Tertullian. This is really the last one I'll give you. But Tertullian, he's a Christian writer, and a teacher. He wrote the earliest known treatise on baptism. And he writes this around AD 210. And in this quote, he's responding to an attack on the importance of baptism. And here's what Tertullian has to say. The subject of this treatise is the mystery of that water by which the sins of our original blindness are washed away and we are set free for eternal life. It will serve a useful purpose in building up not only those who are at present under instruction, but also those whose faith is similarly vulnerable through inexperience because they have been content to believe without examining the reasons for the traditions they've received. In point of fact, a viper from the Cainite heresy, this was a form of Gnosticism, who recently spent some time here, succeeded in carrying off a fair number with her poisonous teaching. And one of its primary features was an assault on baptism. That was natural enough, since vipers and asps and even basilisks generally frequent arid and waterless places. But we are little fishes, called after our great fish, Jesus Christ. We are born in water and can only survive by staying in water. So this monstrosity of a woman who had no right to teach, even if it had been sound doctrine, knew very well how to kill little fishes by taking them out of water. You see, now, I've given you a string there from the beginning into the beginning of the third century. But let me read you what Greg Allison says, somebody who can put a larger scope on. I'll give you two quotes on that. Greg Allison is a professor of Christian theology at Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. And in his book, Historical Theology, An Introduction to Christian Doctrine, he says this. How was baptism understood in the early church? Tertullian listed four purposes that baptism serves. Forgiveness of sins, deliverance from death, regeneration or the new birth, and the gift of the Holy Spirit. To this list, another two will be added. The renunciation of Satan and identification with Jesus Christ. These things were given different emphases by the various leaders during the first few centuries, but all six ends played a key role in the theology of baptism in the early church. Is that the first bell? Oh, good. Ah. All right. Now, let me read to you what Everett Ferguson said. Everett Ferguson, as you know, he's a scholar in Churches of Christ, but he's very well known. He was the editor of the Encyclopedia of Early Christianity, took his degree in church history from Harvard. I mean, Ferguson's internationally known as a scholar of the early church. And here's what he says in the book Early Christians Speak. And he says, the unanimity and vigor of the early second century statements about baptism are presumptive of a direct relationship between baptism and forgiveness of sins from the early days of the church. The consistency with which second century authors make the statements which they do would have been impossible if this had not been the common Christian understanding earlier. It is inconceivable that the whole Christian world reversed its understanding of the meaning of its central rite of conversion within 50 years of the lifetime of the apostles. Do you see what he's saying? He says, look, you have the apostles here in the first century going into the 90s with John. And then all we see in the second century is this complete unanimous understanding that baptism is in fact connected to forgiveness. He says, if the apostles in the first century had not held that same conviction, how could you have had such a radical reversal of understanding within such a short period of time? And moreover, how could that happen without leaving a trail of debate? You see, how could it happen? So the point is that when you go through and you do your work, your exegetical work, and you see these things, you say, yeah, that seems clear to me. You go then and you check that against the early church's understanding, and all you get is an amen. Just completely says, that's how he understood it. And the church understood that forever. You see, I mean, like we get to give the impression today sometimes that it's only people in Churches of Christ or only in the conservative Christian churches that believe baptism is linked to salvation, but that's false. Beasley Murray, the Baptist scholar, he said that the rite of baptism is represented in the New Testament as necessary for salvation is believed by many exegetes. Many exegetes. In fact, the connection between baptism and salvation, that was accepted doctrine for 1,500 years of church history. Everybody understood that. It was not until Huldrych Zwingli in the early 16th century that the view that baptism was unrelated to salvation arose. He is the one who comes up with that idea, and he did it as an overreaction to the Roman Catholic error of baptismal regeneration. Remember, I talked about that last week, the idea that salvation is somehow tied to the rite independent of faith. You see, that God has somehow imbued the rite, that here salvation and these things lie in the performance of the rite itself rather than the place where God acts on the penitent believer. You see, so that was baptismal regeneration. He overreacted to that and winds up saying, well, baptism's not at all connected. It has no link at all. Martin Luther, who is a great Reformation leader, he never considered baptism optional for salvation. Martin Luther wrote, it is solemnly and strictly commanded that we must be baptized or we shall not be saved. Now, people wound up saying to Luther, they said, well, listen, critics said to him, you know, your view of baptism, that's a kind of work salvation. To which Luther responded, yes, it's true that our works are of no use for salvation. Baptism, however, is not our work, but God's. So that's what Martin Luther said. John Calvin. Calvin also rejected Zwingli's view that this is idea that somehow baptism is unrelated, that God's not actually doing anything, that it's simply a symbol, that's simply something that feeds the eyes. He also rejected that. John Mark Hicks, who's a theologian in Churches of Christ, he says, both Luther and Calvin opposed the innovations of Zwingli. As the Augsburg Confession affirms, baptism is no mere profession among men, but it is a sign and testimony of the will of God toward us so that faith believes the promises that are set forth and offered, and baptism is necessary for salvation. That's Article 9 of that confession. This is not a secret. It's not a surprise. It's not idiosyncratic. It's not odd. In the flow of history, it is mainstream Christian doctrine. Okay? And I just get the sense sometimes that we're defensive. No, you know, somebody's off base. I don't think it's us. You see, all right, I heard that bell. Thanks.